Hello and welcome to yet another pre-budget program right here on NDTV. Remember, this is budget in the time of a pandemic, and naturally there will be great expectations from the government as to what will be done, what will be announced in this budget that will take us out of a financial crisis that ensued. Nobody saw it coming, but a lockdown imposed in a manner it was created a situation where we reach levels of minus 23.9% of the GDP. But now it's slowly recovering. What else needs to be done to further increase the pace of growth for the Indian economy in a post-pandemic scenario? I have with me a very special panel of guests. This is a FICCI pre-budget memorandum which has been presented to the government, and we'll look at them in great detail as we go along. I want to welcome the guests who are joining us. Shubhrakant Panda, Vice President of FICCI, Managing Director of Indian Metals and Ferro Alloys Limited. Thank you very much. We also have Nenalal Kidwai, Past President of FICCI, Chairman of Agent Private Equity. Thank you very much, ma'am, for joining us. Jyotsna Suri, Past President of FICCI and Chairman of the FICCI Tourism Committee and Chairman and MD of the Lalit Suri Hospitality Group. Thank you very much to you too, ma'am. And in just a short moment, we'll also have Rasesh Shah, Past President of FICCI and Chairman of the Edelweiss Group, joining us. Okay, let me begin with you, Mr. Panda. I've seen that FICCI has made certain recommendations to the union government. Would you like to take us through what these recommendations are? Some of the key highlights, maybe.
Thank you very much, Sanket. I will focus my remit to manufacturing.
Sure.
First of all, what I would like to clarify is that, budget is not a be-all and a end-all exercise. I think even leading up to it, there's been a lot of work that has been done by the government, be it ease of doing business reforms or the PLI scheme, which is indeed a blockbuster scheme, which I think will have a very good impact on the manufacturing sector. But coming specifically to the budget, I think the specific points that FICCI has made, one is that it is very important to have a focus on infrastructure. Because not only will investment in infrastructure provide an impetus to demand, but one of the challenges to manufacturing in India is also high logistics costs, and that to quite a bit quite an extent will be mitigated with the ongoing investment in infrastructure. Besides that, what we have highlighted is the need to bring down the cost of capital in India, and that can be done by one of two methods, which is to issue long-term Build India bonds, over a 25 to 50-year duration, which will help us lock in the historically low interest rates which are prevalent at the moment. And also, we have built up a very large war chest of foreign exchange reserves. And, a small portion of that, maybe just 5 to 10%, being set aside for lending in dollar terms to long gestation projects like infrastructure, again, mm-hmm. will help bring down the cost of capital. And two other quick points. One, I think it is very important to have a significant emphasis on research and development. And to that extent, FICCI has recommended that the 200% weighted deduction mm-hmm. for R&D be brought back, be reintroduced, mm-hmm. because it is imperative, as I said, that if India is to move along and take its place in terms of being a modern economy, then it is important for us to innovate and be a hub of innovation. Mm. And finally, the low tax rate which had been announced for new investments in the manufacturing sector had a requirement that production should commence by March 2023. Given that a year has sort of been cast aside due to the pandemic, it's FICCI's recommendation that in fact that deadline should be extended to 2025, enabling companies to really go ahead and make their investments and avail this benefit. Mm.
Okay. Ms. Kidwai, let me come to you now. Some of the points Mr. Panda has mentioned, he's largely looked into the manufacturing sector, which is a crucial sector. I wanted to ask you, from the point of view of the Atmanirbhar package that was announced by the government, its implementation, keeping that in mind, what do you think needs to be done going forward from this union budget onwards?
Well, let me start by saying that, we have been fortunate that the whole COVID infliction looks like something we have managed our way out of now quite well. Having said that, we are still struggling as in terms of achieving a GDP growth level at the pre-pandemic level. So even with the best estimates, you know, it'll be 2022 before we begin to see the same sort of levels that we saw before. Now, I like to start this preamble only because I think even as we look at Atmanirbhar, Atmanirbhar is about ensuring effective production in India, and FICCI has always maintained that this production needs to be at a competitive industry level. Mm. We should manufacture world-class goods at world-class prices so that it is not seen as a self-reliance scheme, which the government has repeatedly assured us is not the case, but that we have a competitive industry. Now, the biggest advantage we have as a country is our consumer base, as you well know. How do we bring that consumption back? And I think the underlying message has to be that it's too early for us to withdraw stimulus packages, too early for us to rest our laurels on how things are recovering. We need to push that consumption so it helps Atmanirbhar on the one hand, and on the other helps us get back to our rightful GDP growth rates of the pre-COVID level. And in order to do that, a lot of what started to happen through RBI in terms of interest rates now being maintained. We have to make sure that they don't begin to creep up, liquidity availability, support to sectors which are still struggling. I think real estate, hotels, to some extent aviation, still needing a lot of support. I'm a big believer that unless we can get our real estate sector back on track, and I'm really glad to see how states like Maharashtra have given this a push, become important, because infrastructure is, of course, a very high focus for us from FICCI. But real estate is even more immediate than infrastructure because it brings in the cement, steel sectors, it brings in construction, it brings in employment.
Correct.
It begins to give consumption and money back to the people. So I would like to see tax rates being maintained. I would like to see money being left as in, or even reduced in the case of tax rates, but certainly not going up. No extra cesses. Leave money in the hands of people so we can continue to push consumption, which will help Atmanirbhar, which will help industry, which will help us get our GDP back to where it needs to be, because we are still a ways away from where we were and where we need to be.
That's right. But, you know, given the fact that the government, too, has seen a dip in revenue, so this is a delicate balance that one has to strike within the government as well. But I'm going to come back to you, Ms. Kidwai, to talk in greater detail about that. Dr. Suri, you know, you are the chairperson and MD of the Lalit Suri Hospitality Group. The hospitality sector took a fair bit of beating because of the lockdown. Do you think there is anything specific that one must expect for the hospitality sector to revive this sector that can be announced in this budget now that the vaccine is there?
Thank you, Sanjay. Anita, I personally think that, and that's my personal take on what the budget exercise is, it's merely an accounting exercise. And for our industry, we don't need to wait for the budget. You know, we need policy changes. I don't envy the finance minister at all. She's got a huge balancing act, as you very rightly pointed out, because it's going to be extremely difficult for her to balance out the expense that they are incurring as well. But coming back to my industry, you know, we have been completely wiped out. And currently, we are all functioning, and we are now in the last quarter of the financial year. We are functioning at about minus 80% of last year. Most of us are barely being able to stand up on our own feet. We've been given some support with the moratorium. The moratorium was only for 6 months, not enough. We've been allowed a one-time restructuring, but that restructuring is becoming such a big issue because you can actually implement the restructuring all the way till June. However, the moratorium finished in August. So from September onwards, how do we service our debt? We don't have the money to even take care of our employees and our operational costs. How do we service the debt? So our request has been that at least the moratorium should be extended for this full financial year. So take it up till 31st of March 2021 at least, and perhaps then look at it going forward. Secondly, the restructuring, the ratios that they were proposing to us, with all due respect to the Kamat Committee, we are expected to be back at pre-COVID in 2022, which is absolutely impossible because those ratios were even difficult to meet pre-COVID days. Mm. And with this year being wiped out completely, we're going to be a bit negative this year, a bit negative next year, perhaps a little balance in the year following. So that window needs to be extended to 4 years as against 2 years. So that's another request that we put out. And of course, the interest rate. The interest rate is still too high. And there needs to be more clarity that the RBI has to give to the banks, because the banks are putting forward their own aspects. And it's becoming extremely difficult for all of us who have more than one bank. So if you have a consortium, it becomes impossible to convince all the other bankers. So I think clarity is what we require. Are we expecting anything in the budget? Really, I like I said, you know, our industry needs much more than an announcement of the budget. The budget will be there for sure, but we can get our support before the budget or after the budget, and preferably before the budget, because that moratorium really needs to get extended.
Okay. Let me quickly come back to Mr. Panda. I've been seeing the points that have been mentioned in the pre-budget memorandum of FICCI, and there are some interesting suggestions. For instance, scheme for MNREGA for the urban poor, which should be considered. It also says that you want to consider making employees' contribution to EPF voluntary and accelerate the pace for infrastructure investments. Now, the point on infrastructure investments was made very briefly in some context by Ms. Kidwai. But Mr. Panda, would you like to elaborate a little on the first two? Why do you feel that employees' contribution to EPF should be voluntary? Because what the government is doing as of this moment is exactly the opposite.
Well, let me put it this way. What FICCI has tried to come out with in its list of suggestions is some out-of-the-box thinking to see how one can provide more impetus to consumer spending. And one of the effects of making EPF contribution voluntary is that it leaves more more money in the hands of the employee to go out and spend. Similarly, in that context, what we have what we have recommended or suggested about the urban MNREGA program is again a question of a means to get more money out into the hands of the average consumer, which can be then the start of a virtuous cycle. We've also made other recommendations which can go a long way to sort of boost employment. For example, the scheme that the government has announced whereby that there are certain support measures that the government will provide in case of new employment generation. It has a threshold of 25,000 rupees per month being the salary. And we have recommended that if that can be raised to a level of about 1 lakh rupees a month, then that covers a broader section of people and can provide a boost to employment, which is something that will be an area of concern, as the effect of the pandemic might well linger a little bit longer, even though obviously with the start of the vaccination drive, we hope that this is something which will be consigned to the annals of history sooner rather than later.
Okay. Ms. Kidwai, I want to come back to you. You spoke about how any forms of cesses or taxes, at this point at least, that the government must resist that temptation. It should stay where it is, perhaps come down. But see, the government's logic is, how do you expect us to fund initiatives or welfare schemes if we don't have money? It's a crisis situation for the government coffers also. So at a time like this, what would you recommend? What can be the best way going forward?
You know, it really, as Jyotsna said and as Subrakant is highlighting, it is not easy going forward with any suggestions in an environment where our fiscal deficit, as we are expecting, may well be at the 7.5% level where we had committed to 3.5%. Now, it, to my mind, is not going to be the right time to begin to tighten the purse strings. And I think that's where all of us are really in on the same page in terms of increasing consumption. And I believe that if we can set out in a transparent way a policy which shows that we are looking in the medium term to commitments on our fiscal policy and not try and secure that this year, but do it in a transparent way with data, defending it, showing the seriousness, demonstrating that, you know, all the surplus land, real estate, the stuff that is non-productive and that government holds is available to fund us through this period. We see another year of stimulus where India's stimulus has still been low. I mean, comparative when it comes to emerging markets, but much lower than developed economies. And we do that with this in mind, that the spend, whether it's towards you know, these excellent programs like MGNREGA at the urban level, as Vicky's suggesting, or keeping consumption in the hands of people is important. And let me tell you, the direct taxes are really not such a huge collection amount for government. But the effect it has on people, the perception also of comfort that it gives people is as important. The same way as a well-performing stock market gives a feeling of wealth, and people that are in the stock markets may go out and spend and buy that car that they have been putting off for a while.
Yeah.
And this becomes important at a time when, let's not forget, people have lost jobs.
Correct.
The household saving is down. We are still not at the pre-pandemic level whether it comes to household consumption or household spending. And it's going to be important for us to continue to focus to bring that comfort and that spending back to people. So this is not going to be the year to tighten purse strings, recognizing that it is a tough balancing act.
Correct, correct. Dr. Suri, you know, this cycle has to begin for any economy to thrive. You have to have the cycle of demand, jobs, supply, demand, job creation, supply. This cycle has to keep moving. Do you think a lot has been done in this regard? As Ms. Kidwai was saying, a lot of job losses. You, in your sector also, many people have gone unemployed. Do you think enough has been done to create or get this wheel spinning? And if not, then what needs to be done specifically?
Well, you know, we as a sector have not received anything specific. Job losses are massive. I mean, we probably, as you know, that the travel, tourism and hospitality industry is one of the largest employers. And this goes across all sectors. So let's not just look at the five-star luxury. We start from the top to the bottom, to the homestays as well. So a lot of people are self-employed as well on this in this sector. There have been massive job losses, and there will be more. It hasn't come to an end as yet, because if we are not able to sustain, and that is something that I'm really, really careful of, then let's not look at the big players. You know, I think we need to understand that there are a handful of big players, but the bulk of this industry are small entrepreneurs who could be running a travel agency or who could be having a homestay. These are people who are not being able to sustain themselves. So some of them may not have too many employees, but some have shut shop already. And the ones who are slightly in the middle range are have either put their employees on furlough or the employees have lost their jobs. I'm afraid that this sector or this segment is going to really suffer more and more. Nothing specific has happened for us. You know, I must say that we've been talking to the relevant people and we've got a listening ear. They are all empathetic and sympathetic to this industry. But has anything specific happened for us? No. I don't want to make comparisons with the rest of the world because there are developed economies who have done a lot for the travel, tourism and hospitality sector.
Sure.
I don't think that we can compare because ours is a much larger country and there are many other issues that need to be looked at. But am I expecting anything that will have come through the budget? No, I'm not. Yes, demand and the consumer demand has to be pushed. So we even recommended that, for example, we're not seeing any international tourists at all, and I don't think that's going to happen for the next year or so. Now, if we were to push the domestic demand, we are focusing on domestic tourism at the moment. If we were to incentivize that, and that's something that we've asked for from FICCI, is that if we can incentivize the domestic movement, and how do you incentivize it? By giving some tax rebate, whether it's personal or whether it's company, it would really help and it might spur the demand.
Okay. I have Mr. Rasesh Shah also, Chairman Edelweiss Group and past president of FICCI with us. Thank you very much, Mr. Shah, for joining us. We were just discussing what has been part of, or what is part of the pre-budget memorandum of FICCI. One of the, first of all, your initial comments, and then maybe after that you can answer this question specific to a proposal which says large and well-governed NBFCs should be converted into banks. How is that going to help, Mr. Shah?
I think... as we have seen, I think the last 1 year, the government and Reserve Bank have been able to salvage the economy mainly using the, you know, the liquidity and the monetary side of that. We are hoping that in this budget, even the fiscal side, government has been very prudent in spending money up till now. They have held back their ammo. But we do think that though things are improving, it needs a boost from the government. And what we have done on the monetary side can be done on the fiscal side. Now, to answer your question, on the monetary side, for economy to grow, credit growth is going to be very important. And we are not looking at the next 1 year. If you look at the next 5 to 10 years, if India's ambition of being a $5 trillion and then a $10 trillion GDP is to be achieved, we have to increase credit availability in the economy, especially to the SMEs and the smaller firms and the individual borrowers and all, which has been not available for a lot of even credit-worthy borrowers have not got credit. So our current credit to GDP ratio is close to about 50-55%. Country of our size, scale, and our growth rate ambitions should be close to 100%. So we need to increase credit availability, credit delivery, and eventually also credit cost for a, for a lot of borrowers in India. For that, I think the banking system needs to be expanded. So in the past, as you know, we had PSU banks. Then we added private banks. We have a little bit of bond market, but in the last couple of years, it has gone through its own upheaval. And we have NBFCs. These are the four categories of institutions which deliver credit to the individuals. I think the banking part has been really very robust, and we expanded from PSU banks to private banks. We have seen a huge increase in credit. I think NBFCs, which are now about 20% of the total credit market, at least 10% of that can be converted into bank, which will improve reach and reduce the cost of credit, because NBFC credit is expensive because NBFC cost of borrowing is higher. And the other is NBFCs have become large. So if they are governed like banks, that will be good for the system as a whole also. So from increasing credit as well as from stability of the financial system, converting large NBFC into banks could be a good step now.
Okay. And before we go, this one point, Mr. Shah, I see in the recommendations that you want, the FICCI wants, abolition of anti-profiteering provision in the GST law. Now, how is this going to help?
See, ultimately, we have to, we talk about ease of doing business. And part of ease of doing business is make it easier for the markets to operate. And there is, and especially for anti-profiteering, it was required at that time when GST was introduced. In fact, I remember it was introduced with a clear caveat that this is only for the next 1 or 2 years, where because GST rates are changing, that immediate change should not result in any profiteering. Like for some item, if the GST rate has fallen, the company should pass it on to the consumers and not profiteer out of that. But even at that time, it was envisaged that after a couple of years, this clause is not needed because the market will do its own work. If there is enough competition in the market will make sure that companies' profits are capped, because any company, if they are trying to excessively profiteer, the competition will reduce their profits for them. So we need to allow the markets and the regulations to do their work rather than have one more agency out there. Because as you know, in India, we have a lot of agencies looking at how business is done. There is no need to have one more agency which also looks at anti-profiteering. as a result of GST, because it was required when the transition happened.
Sure.
Now we are 3 years into the transition. I think that anti-profiteering body has outlived its original objective. Even at that time, it was controversial. Now I think after 3 years, there is no need for that.
Sure. Okay. Mr. Panda, Mr. Shah, Nena Lal Kidwai, as well as Dr. Suri, thank you so much for joining us and sharing with us your insights on what you feel the budget must offer. Stopping for a short break. Do keep watching all the news and updates right here on NDTV.